In this final segment on OpenGL, we are going to talk about texture mapping, which is responsible for the wooden floor on the MyTest 3 demo. So here is the new globals and the basic setup. Before that, I'll just show a very brief demo of the program. So this is the idea, and all that's happened is we've replaced the white floor with the wood texture. First, I define the wood texture, and that can be any image. In this case, it's 256 by 256 with RGB. Then I have to define a lot of other stuff in order to get texturing to work. So text names is texture buffer. In this case, I have only one texture, so it's an array of length 1. Do I texture or not is light for lighting. Texturing equals to 1 to turn on and off texturing. Lighting is equal to 1 to turn on and off lighting. So again, if I go to my demo, I can turn off the texture by pressing the T key. I can turn it on by pressing the T key again. In display, I set the isLight command to 0. So I turn off the lighting except for the teapot. I turn isText to texturing, which again, I can be toggled with the T key. And then I draw the texture on the floor with the texture names buffer 0, and that's the only element in the buffer. Finally, I set isText to 0 so that other items aren't textured. So simple toggles for the keyboard. T turns on and off texturing. S turns on and off shading. We haven't shown that, but it's something you might want to try. What is the idea of texturing? It's really one of the remarkable breakthroughs in computer graphics when it was developed in the 1970s, because earlier to then, if you wanted to create an image, for example, of this dinosaur here, and you wanted it to have the nice dinosaur texture that you imagine dinosaurs actually had, then you would have to actually break the geometry into small regions and color each triangle separately. And then maybe you could use gouache shading to interpolate those colors. But that requires you to have maybe a million triangles to represent your geometry, which is really difficult and makes your 3D graphics slow down. So in the early 70s, it was thought that this was a fundamental limitation to computer graphics. Texturing separates the rate or the frequency at which shading varies from the representation of geometry. The idea is that you supply an image and you add detail in this image-based way. So if you had a plane like a floor or a desk, then you can represent it using only 4 vertices for the rectangle that the plane is specified by. But then you also specify an image that gets mapped onto the plane, and that's texture. Of course, images can be mapped onto more complicated shapes as well. It's not entirely trivial how to do that, but you specify texture coordinates at each triangle. And in this way, it's really a very basic primitive throughout the graphics pipeline. You separate out the geometry from the texture. In the real world, most surfaces are textured, and so here's a simple example of a scene with just a polygonal model on the left and with surface texture on the right. And of course, this makes it look more realistic. And so you can add things like wood grain, face textures, bricks, which adds a lot of visual detail to scenes and can be done in a fragment shader. So the setting up the texture, you initialize the texture of the wood in the shader program. And here is very basic code to read a PPM file. I know that PPM files are not very popular nowadays, and so you can replace this with using an image library to read an appropriate file. But I like it because the format is really very simple. So you open the file name, you read the first line is P6, the width of the file 256, 256, and you skip the new line. And so you read in the wood texture. Then you specify texture coordinates. Each vertex must have texture coordinates. So what you do is you use standard rasterization or gouache shading hardware to interpolate these texture coordinates. And then for each fragment or pixel, you use that interpolated value to look up the texture rather than simply to interpolate the colors. So here is a lot of code to set this up. So gen textures 1 text names gives you a number to use for the first texture. You bind the buffers to the num objects times num per obj plus num colors. So the last buffer will be the texture buffer. You define the buffer data. You activate texture 0. You can have multiple textures in the scene. You enable 2D texturing. Then you have to come to the texture coordinates. and you have to enable the client state for the texture coordinate array, and you have to bind the 2D texture to the texture names buffer. Again, I mean, if you look up texturing in OpenGL, you'll find a lot of resources on the web. I've given you the basic code you need to do that. So specifying the texture image, this is done with the gltextimage2d command. The target is always gltexture2d. Level is 0, that's used for MIP mapping if you want textures at many different level scales. Components 3 or 4, the width must be a factor of 2. And you can specify glrgb, and you can specify the textures unsigned, bind, float, etc. So specifying the texture image using this texture2d, glrgb, the size of the texture, unsigned byte and wood texture. Then you specify the minification and magnification of textures. This is a topic we don't have a lot of time to get into. Essentially, a texture has a given size, but if it's mapped onto a surface, it may be stretched or it may be shrunk. And either way, you need to know how to interpolate. In this, we are just supplying simple linear interpolation, but you can do more interesting things. You can also specify nearest if you just want nearest neighbor interpolation. Linear is satisfactory for us. Finally, if you get a texture value which is greater than the range of the texture, what should you do? And so you can clamp to the endpoints of the texture, or you can just repeat the texture infinitely. Finally, you need to define what's known as a sampler for the texture. And it just gets it gets bound to this location text in my program. And I set it to 0 corresponding to GL texture 0. IsText is bound to the IsText location in the program. Drawing with the texture, again, I define the offset for the particular object and the base to the end of the array. I bind the vertices and enable the vertex array. I bind the colors and I enable the color array. All of that is just what we did earlier, but now we're going to also talk about the textures. So you define texture 0 as the active texture. You enable texture 2D. And here comes the real part to define the texture. You bind the texture here, and then you enable the client state with the texture coordinate array. So GLU int texture is what you should use for this binding here that's specified from the main program. And then you bind the buffer for the texture coordinates. You define the texture coordinate pointer. And then finally, you draw the object in the standard way. So this is the general idiom of how you draw with textures. You can, of course, also find many other resources and tutorials online. The final steps for drawing is first you define the vertex shader, which just passes on the texture coordinates, giving you the multi-texture coordinate 0 because your texture 0. And the fragment shader can, of course, do more complicated things, but in this case, we just look up the texture 2D. And here you're looking up text, which is the sampler here, and you're looking texture coordinate 0, ST is the standard thing for the texture. Of course, you don't have to reset the fragment color to the texture. You can modulate the lighting calculation, and you can do other interesting things. Just want to show you the demo again, that you have this texture of the floor. And it's just, I can turn it on and I can turn it off.